नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग. यस, प्लीज कम. टुडे वी गोइंग टू स्टडी समथिंग दैट यू विल रियली एंजॉय, बिकॉज दीज आर इंस्पिरेशनल पीपल हु हैव रियली वर्कड इन इंडियन डांस एंड दे हैव सेट देयर ओन पाथ्स एंड मे बी यू विल दे विल हेल्प. नोइंग अबाउट देम विल हेल्प यू टू सेट योर ओन paths. Among the three who really have made significant contribution and difference to dance in India today and dance body and dance scene in last 25 years in India are Daksha Sheth, Aditi Mangaldas and Navtej Singh Johar. All have done in their own way, stuck to a sincerity of form and medium, and traveled new paths without sacrificing their soul or selling it to the system. The genius of Daksha Sheth lies in her grasp of tradition, her understanding of the contemporary tests, and her command over the dance material and theme, choreographies, music, costume, lights. Not many have all the essential ingredients in the place. Daksha's journey from being a trained Kathak dancer under Kumudini Lakhia of exceptional merit to learning Mayur Bhanchau and Kalari, coupled with her familiarity with Tai Chi and Taekwondo, has wasted in her the possibility of bending not only merely her body but also her mind any and which way. She is open to new sensibilities and is sensitive to trends nationally for display internationally. Daksha was born and brought up in the city of industrial fumes, Ahmedabad. There was no dance in her family. Kumudini taught us perseverance and patience by learning, working and serving her interest. We assimilated the Guru Shishya Parampara the truly hard way. No wonder none of Kumudini's students has stayed with her for long. Daksha, Aditi, Ishira, Maulik, Parul, they all have gone their separate ways, tired of maybe her demanding ways or her opening of eyes to them. Daksha and Delhi. In year 1982, it brought her to the beautiful capital city, yet to see the ruin caused by Maruti culture. Daksha enrolled for Mayurbhan Chau classes at the Sriram Bhartiya Kala Kendra and learned the style from one of its masters, Guru Krishna Chandra Nayak. Bharat Sharma, the wolf boy, was in her class. It was in this class too that she found a lanky Australian, Isa Rowe, who was in search of the song of life. Having heard the Dagar Bandhu, he came down from caves in Himalayan region where he had sat meditating and immerse himself in music and the muse. The attraction that he and Daksha felt for each other was a bonding of the souls. Delhi's politics and pollution tired Daksha, and she next moved to Mathura, like a gopi searching for Krishna. Her Krishna, however, was with her, and when they made Vrindavan their home, courtesy the Radha Raman temple, they were blessed with Tao, a little Krishna indeed. In Vrindavan, Daksha revived the evening aarti tradition and offered dance. Thus, the name of her dance company, Aarti, was thought of. Still not satisfied after a few years of playing Meera in Krishna land, Daksha heard of a village close to Veerappan land, Hasar Ghat in Karnataka, where Pratima Bedi was trying to set up dance Gurukul. Daksha, with bags and kids and husband in tow, arrived at Pratima's tent and will build the place, Nrityagram, digging earth with our own hands. Our sweat and toil has gone into that institution, says Pratima. She was more interested in good praise than in good dance. Did not do much for dance, although it did make the institution come alive initially. But the gurus found the arrogance of the girls, all self-styled stars, difficult to deal with, and so most have left, never to return. Today, Nrityagram is dead like its founder, says some, but today Nrityagram is also the flagship of Odissi all over the world. Initial stages, as you know, a lot of things change and develop. One needs to sustainably do the work, continue doing the work to go further. And so Daksha's last stop was Thiruvananthapuram. She says, I found a patch of land and decided we need a final resting place. So that is where we stuck our root. It was such a long journey, but how rewarding, every bit of it. If Vivaldi's summer in 1986 was an indication of things to come, then Adya in 1987 and Yatra in 87 set the tone. Vivaldi's summer remained a classic because it shows that innovation is about. It is not just about trying to do something, because it shows new on the stage. It is doing something that holds, has a language and a grammar and can be enjoyed. The simple use of Kathak Tatkars, the device of Western ballet leaps and the use of chakra made this item stand apart, and Daksha gets request to perform it even today. Timepiece, Modern Times and Chaya happened in 1988. The next year saw Mahishasur Mardini, Kaliya Daman and Govinda Lila, but those were the Mathura Vrindavan years. Ashtayam in 1992, followed by Yagna in the same year, made everyone sit up and take notice of the fact that Daksha had arrived with a dance company of merit. The intricate development of esoteric themes integral to Indian culture stood translated for stage, a feat in itself. The productions were tight and not a minute longer than required. Unconsciously, Daksha was following Uday Shankar's adage. What you can do in 20 minutes, why sketch it to 50? Most Indian dancer choreographers bore audiences with unedited megalomania, but it is time to make it short and sweet, felt Daksha. No, Daksha did not offer merely short and sweet works, but even her 2 hour long productions like Search for My Tongue in 1994-95 were packed with pace, suspense, drama and dance. The hallmark of someone who had mastered her craft. Daksha's genius was for all to see. Rachna and Sangeetam in 1996 were collaborative projects. Daksha had gone truly international. An unstated sensitivity of the Scandinavian suited her creative spirit. She had a lasting association with Finnish artist. Sarpagati, Daksha's 1997 work, was treated shabbily by critics more concerned with her growing popularity at the cost of older established names than with dance. She was treated like a fallen angel. Ironically, Fallen Angles was the name of her next work, an experimental production mounted in the open space provided by the New British Council Library in Delhi. Good products invite copycats. So many younger dancers trying to copy Daksha's work is not funny. They do not lure away her trained dancers or borrow her choreographic ideas, like the Samudra group of Thiruvananthapuram does. Then they simply snatch bits of her music and dance memory. The ultimate flattery for any artist is to inspire a fellow artist. But in Daksha's case, it goes beyond that. Entire sequences from her Vivaldi or Bukham are lifted. No small contribution to Daksha's worth is Devi Saros. Apart from being a musician with eclectic taste, her husband is soulmate and troupe manager, a one-man support system for Daksha and her art. Their daughter Isha is coming into her own as a sprightly dancer and worked in films and has worked in films like Krishna and Three Idiots and many more. Daksha's son Tao too performed rope tricks in Bukham, a dancing family. Yes, of course. In Kerala, she has created a fine place for thinking about dance. Daksha is a thinking dancer, if ever the title fit anybody. She also worked quietly among the limelight and done much to maintain strictest professional codes. She is a good trainer of raw talent and does mold all her dancers equally well. In all that she undertakes, films or fashion, dance or song, there is inner reflection and space from where she emerges. She is ultimately a yogini. Indian dance today is far richer because of a selfless artist of her caliber has made India her home. Although she could live and work anywhere in the world, and the USA or UK, Canada, Australia, Japan or Africa, her palette is vast and her art deep like an ocean. D for dance and D for Daksha Sheth. After Uday Shankar, in this generation, if there is an original artist, an Indian great, not dependent on patronage and press from the West to show her credentials here, a master of stagecraft, a presenter of the art of dance, in short, a genius, that is her. History will accord her that place of honor. We do. Aditi Mangaldas started learning dance at the age of 5 in Ahmedabad. Slowly, all other activities ceased except dance. The science education at an early age may not have inspired her towards the sciences, though she loved theoretical mathematics and later graduated with it. But it may have increased her propensity to question and not take everything at the given value. Her school shreyas too added to this more open-rounded overall education, and her first Kathak guru, Kumudini Lakhya, completed it. Of all the things that I learned from Kumudini ji, one of the most basic and fundamental was the connection of my body in terms of space and the ambience and other bodies around me. The concept of space and extension, letting the body permeate into various parts of space. And though our training was in strict Kathak, we were always encouraged to have an open mind, not wear blinkers. She herself was such a great pioneer, was challenging norms and challenging what was recognized as tradition. I was lucky to have a family and a guru who both encouraged questioning and were themselves path breakers, says Daksha. Following the kolahal in me, I went to Pandit Birju Maharaj, who was the torch bearer of classical Kathak. It was a magical experience. Besides all the training I received from Maharaj ji, I learned from him the connection with the inner point, the energy point in my body, to love dance as it were human, to be consumed by it, to know the inner bindu of being, is Daksha's saying. Thus says Aditi, the first opportunity arose when I was asked to participate in a festival called Kathak or Kavita, where I had to dance a classical Kathak poem, a traditional Indian poem, and a contemporary poem. I chose Biddadin Maharaj, Mirabai and Agyeji. Quote complete. Among her main works, Varsha would fall into a classical format of Kathak with its Vilambit, Madhya and Drutalaya and all its images, Amad, Paran, Tukda and footwork. Aditi says, with the footprints on water, today I feel I was at the crossroads. It was a great landmark in my evolution. For the first time, I worked with movements that did not fall within the Kathak repertoire. I had started working with different body aesthetics. I danced the entire piece with my back to the audience. The music too felt like an underground stream. Then came Grishma. It was the inner fire conceived. In textures of silence, there was no music. Quote complete. It was about giving a feel of perceived sound through the pregnant silence between two syllables in Kathak. Then came movement and space, which explored using different dance forms. Rhythm and sound was an exploration into the rhythmic pattern of Kathak using different textured floors. We had footwork in water with bells that were made out of shells. We had footwork on earthen pots. We built a skanskip with our dance. The route after this came the phase with my four most recent works, Uncharted Seas, Timeless, Now Is, and Immersed between 2006 and 2010, says Aditi. Classicists at one point of time thought I was too contemporary. Those contemporary used to think I was too classical. Everyone seemed to know everything. Everyone seemed to have an answer. But who was asking the question? Aditi asks. Uncharted Seas was about search. What is it that we search for in life? When we stand outside and look at the stars, don't we ask ourselves, what is our existence all about? The piece was inspired by the poetry of Mirabai, Kabir, Bhartendu Harishchandra. Timeless had a set of questions on time. What is time? Is time cyclic? Is time still? Does time trip? Does time flow? Does time end? Is time still? And are we moving? Can we hold past and future in time present? There was no narrative except the narrative of the body. Of the staging, the choreography, the narrative that was brought out by lights, sound and movement. Next, I choreographed a classical solo called Immersed. I have been fascinated by what Krishna has evoked in Indian culture. I am not religious and I don't belong to any particular formal religion. But to me, Krishna is a character who has given rise to the most incredible poetry, text, dance, architecture, music, says Aditi. Whether one talks of classical, contemporary, or any true artist will view their art form as an ever-flowing river. It is always rejuvenating itself. So, whether it is classical or contemporary, the art has to evolve and grow. Aditi says, my mind goes back to how contemporary the dancers of yore must have been, when the move happened from the temple to the court, to the kota, and now on to the proscenium stage. I presume when you say modern, you mean bring in contemporary sensibilities. As mentioned earlier, any true artist evolves, changes, rejuvenates. For me, as Aditi says, there are two types of explorations. The vertical that go deep into the form and the horizontal that expand the form out. With both these explorations, one can remain within the classical format or let the flowering happen beyond the structure of the classical format. To me, it should come from within. I may not be a prolific teacher. I have just four students, Gauri Divakar, Rashmi Uppal, Anindita Archaji, Rachna Yadav, who in turn have 40 or more students. which I am very proud of. As a teacher, you have to be extremely responsible for how you groom the dancers and to be very present for every possible need so that mind along with the dance can grow. This is what Aditi thinks and talks about. All the four students of mine were part of my repertory, and since I relied so much, they were with me constantly. I think what I would like to tell them is that what Kumudini ji and my Guruji told me, that there are no shortcuts and one has to go through the entire greed of riyas and sadhana to anything. I think, I am sure that all the teachers and all the gurus must be telling this to the students again and again and again, no doubt of that. Keep an open mind and not wear blinkers, because that is what will eventually make you have the courage to dance your own dance. It is my dream, as Aditi says, to put Indian classical dance and contemporary work steaming from it on an international platform, a platform that is not India or South Asia centric, but that is on par with any great dance from anywhere in the world. I place my work in the context of the now. May it be my classical work or my contemporary work that stems from the classical. I would, in a way, not like my work to be labeled, as I hope that I can constantly reinvent myself and my work. To be satisfied with one's own success is the first nail in the coffin of creativity. I hope that I can relook at my work critically, move on and away from my successes, learn from my failures and reinvent, is the talk of Aditi. And now let's look at the third thinking dancer, which is Navtej Singh Johar. A purist delight and a connoisseur's light is Navtej Singh Johar. Having learned Bharatanatyam from Kalakshetra, he developed his own language of the art form, a language devoid of banality, though not bereft of Bharatanatyam. He has infused his dance with yoga too. Today, on the yoga day, we are learning and trying to understand the creativity of two important dancers who have really used yoga in their dance creations. Says Navtej, in the last 10 years, I can say that my work has been gradually consolidating and developing a cleaner voice and multi-layered focus that simultaneously deals with aesthetics, poetics, politics, history, and of late, philosophy. I got this through reviewing some of my important works through the last decade. In 2005 and 6, I made two versions of Fana, Ranja Revisited. The work juxtaposed the popular love legend of Heer Ranja from Punjab with Kutral Kurvanji from Tamil Nadu, seamlessly crossing boundaries of culture, language and music. The piece was made in collaboration with Sufi scholar, expert and musician Madan Gopal Singh and Carnatic composer and vocalist Ilango Govindarajan, and its underlying thrust was to challenge the hierarchies of low and high art. In 2008, says Navtej, I made Mango Cherry Mix in collaboration with Japanese dancer choreographer Hirososhi Miyamoto, in which we explored the openness to sensuality as reflected through the position of pleasure women in our culture, that is geishas, devadasis and tawaifs. In 2010, I made two works. The first was Dravyakaya, based on Ramayana. It focused not on the characters, but the props found in the epic. That is like the Kodanda bow, the Valkala Vastra and such. It was an attempt to reclaim a text that has been co-opted into the right-wing agenda post Babri Masjid. The second work was Grey Is Also a Color, a dancer theatre solo inspired by Doris Lessing's novel. The Grass Is Sinking is examined and illustrated the opposition of class and color inequalities in apartheid South Africa. In 2012, Navtej made Charumati Claire sing that juxtaposed the Devadasis with the Maids of Jean Garrett. That year, he also made a collaborative work with German choreographer Ben J. Reib. Don't Ask, Don't Tell that dealt with the idea of eroticism and its repression in dance today. Navtej Johar's recent work, Frenemies, is a male duet that again places itself within the ghettoized existence of Devadasi and other one, Janet's Maids. It explores the expanse and lightness of the amorous love song, the Padam and the Thumari, an attempt to shift its locale from heart to the materiality of the body. Navtej says, I also base my dance work on the practice and philosophy of yoga. One tool of yoga that helps me significantly as a dancer is the technique of Ujjayi breath that is so widely used in our tradition, that of Sri Krishnamacharya. Ujjayi is a method of chest breathing that directly awakens the spine and B, makes the breath subtle, audible, thus making the practice auto-engaging as the practitioner is not only modulating but also simultaneously being able to hear the breath. Thus, through this dual process of both doing and gogging, I, the practitioner, come to stand at the center of my practice. Music continues to play a very vital part in my work, says Navtej. Of late, I have also started to use voice and singing in performance. My work is almost always making a comment on dance, its inherent eroticism, its fabricated histories, and the hierarchies that prevail within it. So history, both political and philosophical, plays a major role in my work, in my dance. To me, Indian dance is not an innocent or a simple affair. It is hugely complex, politically driven and oppressed under a variety of agenda. My attempt is to find autonomy for dance as for the body within context that is hugely manipulative and oppressive. These are the three dancers that are really path breakers in Indian classical dance of these times. Thank you. Hope you've enjoyed the lecture and have learned or are now dreaming of your future. Namaste.